several policy changes in light of the death of Jim Rogers. In that case, were the officers here on this day following the directives of flawed policy, or were they outside of policy? And if they were outside of policy, why change it?
Well, you know, it's as we were reviewing the officers' actions in regards to the policy, many of the policies were already in place. For instance, when use of force is applied, the officers are supposed to take the arrestee to the medical facility that's closest to the event. So in that case, it would have been West Penn, which was two blocks down the road. Even if it wasn't West Penn, it would have been Shadyside, it could have been Children's, it could have been any of the medical facilities that were closest to the event. However, unfortunately, and I don't know the reason why, Zone 5 has been relying on Mercy Hospital. And when we did a right to know request, then we received, and I want to say this, I have no ill will or animosity towards the city of Pittsburgh or any of the police officers that are involved in this incident. The goal is to ensure that this does not happen again. I know that, you know, this was a hard look. I know that it was tough to watch. I spoke to Ms. Kersnick many times, and she was even reluctant to come because watching it is so painful. But the only way that we can get to a place where we can correct our mistakes is by facing the hard truth. And that's essentially where we are. The policies were already in place. The police officers didn't follow them. And it wasn't that we were talking about, you know, regular street cops. I mean, there was a lieutenant there. There was two sergeants. There were many experienced police officers, some of them I knew personally, who either knew that this policy was in place and didn't follow it, or didn't know that the policy was in place and didn't follow it. You heard in the videos, many of the police officers were saying, we're going to get you medical care. So clearly they knew that he needed medical care. When the EMTs came, they knew the EMTs were there. Why didn't they ensure that he got the medical care that they promised him? Yes, sir.
So when they left the scene, everybody needs to hear.
When they left the scene with him, were they taking him to jail or were they taking him straight to Mercy Hospital?
They were taking him to Mercy Hospital. And I should, you know, I should clarify some things. So there's been a whole lot of, you know, to-do made about why the video wasn't released. Why didn't you release the video, Mr. Hollis, 3 years ago when you got it? I wanted to release the video and everything that came with it. The Criminal History Records Information Act prevents any law enforcement agency from sharing what they call investigative material with members outside of the police community. So, the only way that I was able to gain access to that video was through the lawsuit. When the lawsuit arose, that gave me subpoena power. It allowed me to get the videos. But when you get the videos, you get the information confidentially. So it's a crime to release that confidential information outside of the lawsuit. So had we actually gone to trial and I had to release the information, then of course it would have been a part of the case. It's public information. We all would have had access to it. When I attempted to contact the district attorney's office to ask him to release the information, I got no response. So the only way that I was able to release that video was to fight for it. And the issue is we had already received the settlement money. So why would I then fight so hard to release information that clearly wasn't, you know, pertinent to, you know, the prosecution of my case? And that's because I want transparency. I am not here, you know, to place blame, point fingers, you know, argue with the DA's office, point at any of the police officers that, you know, are involved in this matter. Some of those guys, I know them personally. They have very hard jobs to do. I get it. But a man died over a bicycle. Over a bicycle that was being given away. Even if he stole the bicycle, it wouldn't and shouldn't be a death sentence. I care about my community. I care about my city. This was more about money. I told you it was more about money. This was about transparency. And everything that I had within me, I was going to do to make sure that that information was made public. Now it's made public.
So what's the ask?
I'm not asking.
You're not
gonna do anything? You're not gonna ask. Wait, it's not we, sir. I'm not asking. I'm releasing the information, and now we can have a conversation about it. We can decide whether this is how we want our police force in our city to, sir. So please don't be, sir. We can decide how we want our police force to interact with our citizens. That's what the video was done and the purpose of releasing it was for. That's it. I'm not here to bash any of the police officers. I'm not here to bash the city of Pittsburgh, the DA's office, or anyone else. I'm willing to sit down. I'm willing to have a conversation. I'm willing to address those hard issues so that we can prayerfully move forward to prevent another person from dying from a bicycle. Yes, sir.
Can you speak to the timing of the release of this video? It coming out Monday, this event scheduled for today. Why was it so important to get that video out there a couple days in advance? And now that it is out there, what do you want to see with this being out in the public and everybody being able to watch everything kind of unfold?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understand your question. Can you just ask it one more time?
So with this video being released on Monday on your website ahead of this event this evening, why was it so important for you to get that video out there 2 days in advance?
So it was important for me to take myself out of the equation. I wanted the residents to view the video without me narrating it, without any editorial comments. So you had an opportunity to digest it, and then I was open to having that conversation here today. Sometimes, you know, I mean, my job is to obviously to argue on the best interest of my client. But in this instance, I didn't release the video because it was in the best interest of my client. I released the video because it's in the best interest of our community. And there are some people who are going to obviously disagree with why I did it. And that's fine. I mean, we can have a disagreement, but the conversation needs to be had. We cannot expect to have transparency and secrecy. We can't have, you know, real change while just the policymakers, you know, the so-called important people are making those decisions in closed corners. For that reason, and for that reason alone, it was important to me to release the video to everybody. You know, some of the members of the media that I gave the video to, I didn't always agree with what they wrote, but that's not important. What's important is that you have the truth. What we do with it is up to us as a community.
In the name of transparency, are you planning on releasing any other documents, medical records, anything else related to this case?
I am, absolutely, I am. Tomorrow, we're going to release the expert report from David Wright. I plan to do that.
Attorney Carl, Jim's uncle, not practically raised, but we won't never, not to have a different opinion. I'm not here, and I came here with this idea. You look at it as policy. I didn't see policy. I've seen the COVID should be indicted. If everyone did on the stage, not in. I'm not here. I don't apologize. Nobody ever wrong. And that's what I feel about this. Frankie Reed. You know, I heard you in Boston. I told something to be done. It's like in the cave of floor, and then when it happened to him. This is bad. I mean, it's not just policy, it's more than policy.
I think they were wrong. You don't tase nobody 9 or 10 times and think they can live. I don't care what, whether people are unhealthy or healthy. That'll kill anybody. And the way they did it, they should have some kind of emergency. Nobody's looking at that. And they talk about money. I don't want no money. I'm 84. I don't need no money.
Yes, sir.
I want justice for my nephew. I want people to know that. That's all I got to say.
Yes, sir. First of all, I want to thank you for coming. I appreciate you and your family for being here. It was an honor for me to be a part of this case. And I'm doing everything within my resources to get you the justice that you deserve. I know there was another question, I apologize.
Hey, Todd, thanks. Five of the officers have been reinstated with diminished discipline. And I know two cases are still pending. I was wondering if you could comment on the timing of the release in terms of what this might or might not do to the arbitration process for those two remaining officers.
It's not appropriate for me to comment on that. My understanding is the city of Pittsburgh has an attorney that's working on that matter. I'm not even familiar with, the proceedings. I'm sure that, the attorneys who are representing the police officers in the city of Pittsburgh will act accordingly. So beyond that, I don't have a comment. Anyone else?
I know you said that you have no agenda aside from transparency, but is there any part of you that has considered or even hope that by releasing this publicly, you'll ramp up pressure on the DA's office maybe to reopen a grand jury investigation?
No. I'm not the district attorney. I don't represent the city of Pittsburgh. Yeah. I represent the estate of Jim Rogers.
But from where you stand, do you believe criminal charges should be filed against any of the officers, including Officer Keith Edmonds?
I cannot make an opinion on that. I believe that wouldn't be proper for me to do that at this point. There's ongoing proceedings. I think it's best for me to let those people who are working with that issue resolve that case.
Because it seems like they're family members, as we just heard from his uncle, who really want to hear if there's any...
You just heard it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, given your experience in the law, I mean, from what we saw, did they do anything that had risen to criminal conduct?
I understand what you're getting at, and obviously, I'm not answering that question, and there's reasons for it. Everyone has rights. I have to respect those rights, and I mean, I'm an attorney, so there's things that I can say and there's things that I can't say, and that's something that I can't say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So just a question. Is anybody else scheduled to speak?
Yes.
Tonight?
Yes.
And
yes. Yes.
Yeah, and if it's Tim Stevens or even the uncle, I just wanted to ask them if they thought, just personally, since they're not an attorney, now that they've seen the video, should criminal charges be levied against the officers after now we've all seen this? And since they're not attorneys, they can give opinions on that.
Sure. Well, they will. If no one else has any questions for me, I'll ask Mr. Stevens, and I believe Councilman Mosley is here. I think they both want to talk, so they can probably come up at the same time. No, I don't believe the police department is going to make any statements. Councilman Mosley, Mr. Stevens,
yeah. Good evening, everyone. I'm Councilman Kahari Mosley from the 9th District. First, I just want to send my heart out to the Rogers family. My heart really goes out to you. I can only imagine the grief that you've been dealing with since the loss of Jim, as well as to sit through this and relive all that trauma all over again. I'm going to keep my remarks extremely brief. This was the first time that I have viewed the video, and to say that I'm shocked would be a great understatement. I think incidents like this, make it, extremely difficult, to do the hard work, that we're trying to do to make our community safer, the hard work that we're trying to do to make sure that our folks from law enforcement are accountable to the public. But I do want to thank Commander Mercurio for being here. I want to thank him for being a great partner in the short time that I've been on city council. But it also, you know, makes the hard work even more difficult to improve relations between the community and the police force. I do think that it is very important, for us as public officials, to be in these spaces with the community, regardless of how difficult and how hard it is, to view something like that and be here, particularly, with the family who has to relive, that trauma once again. And I want to ask, the entire community to wrap their arms around Jim Rogers' family, as we continue, a new chapter, in their grieving process as this video becomes public. But I do think I'm not an attorney either, and as a city official, I would choose my words, carefully. But I do think, we need to explore, what further accountability steps need to be taken. And I definitely, will take a role in that and take it back, to City Hall and share, my experiences tonight, with my eight other colleagues on City Council and begin, that journey and that process to explore, what other accountabilities we can step to ensure that not only this never happens again, but if there was, criminal activity involved in this, and I'm not saying there is, because again, I'm not a lawyer, I think we will let the experts, determine that through an exploratory process. But I do think that process, should begin. And I want to thank, everyone, for coming out. And again, I want to ask everybody, most importantly, to wrap their arms around Jim Rogers' family as we continue, the next stage of this process. So, thank you for this opportunity. I'm going to turn the floor back over to Mr. Hollis.
Does anybody else have any other questions?
Two.
I don't have a question, Todd. I just wanted to commend you for your transparency. It's the ball has been dropped when it comes to Allegheny County, the city of Pittsburgh, the FOP, all others, people in positions and the 1% and, of the dominant society. So I just wanted to commend you being transparent and standing by the Rogers family through all of this. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you very much. So, Mr. Stevens, Ms. Stevens, Ms. Fisher, you guys want to say something? Okay. So I want to thank Mr. Stevens. Come on up. Before I let him speak, there's an attorney that is unfortunately not here today. He's sick. He's one of the finest civil rights lawyers that I've had the pleasure of working with. His name is Mark Harris. Not only is he an attorney, but he's also my cousin. I want to wish him well. I hope that, you feel better, Mark. I know you can't be here today. I know you wanted to be, but get well soon, because I need your help. It's rough out here. So, Mr. Stevens.
This is the second time I've seen the video. What we need to remember is, an attorney, correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Rogers sat in the car for 17 minutes or 18? 17 minutes before the automobile was even moved. When you saw the last part of the video, it was actually going back to the earlier part of what happened at the scene. According to the attorney, it took 38 minutes to get to the hospital, passing how many hospitals? Three? One of which was West Penn, which was literally minutes from Harriet Street. So regardless of your orientation on this, you can't help but believe that Mr. Rogers might be alive today if they had followed their own policies. One of the things that we will be addressing from BPEP, the Black Political Empowerment Project, APA, and NAACP, I know that we will be addressing this to the chief, to the safety director, and to the mayor as to what policies and procedures have been initiated, if any, as a result of the death of Jim Rogers. If they have been created, are they being implemented? If not, when? And as the attorney said, what hurts even more is that this happened over a bicycle. Over a bicycle. I was one of those in my position as chair of BPEP, and maybe when I was president of the NAACP, who advocated for the use of tasers. The purpose was to avoid police officers from killing people when they may have an option. And in this case, the option created death. So there's some work to be done, and it must be done.
You got a question, Todd, hold up.
Sure. Well, actually, it's a statement. My name is Carmen Brown, and I was one of the protesters for the Jim Rogers. And I mean, this is so disheartening. But what I want to say to Todd is that, Todd, I don't know, I know that there were a lot of legal avenues that you could have took during that 3-year period. I don't know why you didn't. I mean, you showed the video now, okay. But at the end of the day, if you would have took some other legal avenues, the outcome could have been different. Jim could have got justice. When I called you one day and we talked, I said to you, Todd, no, I'm making a statement. No, I'm making a statement. I got right now. But anyway, I called you, Todd, and I talked to you, and I asked you about the protest. You persuade me, you said, well, it would not be in the interest of my client for you to continue to protest. And so I was trying to do the protest, but a lot of people kind of got deterred because of what you said. So again, there could have been a different outcome. People could have went to jail. There's a lot of policies that were violated in this. But I just say, Todd, you're disingenuous, because you should have done more to make sure that that video got out before you got your $8 million, because that's all you was worried about is your coins. That's all I got to say.
Okay, so thank you very much for your comment. As I said before, the Criminal History Records Information Act precludes the release of confidential information. So, you know, despite what some may believe, if you release information that's given to you confidentially, you'll be charged criminally by the district attorney. It's that simple. All right, so listen, I really appreciate everybody for coming out. Well, I'll address your question another time, but the press conference, I'm sorry.
All right. Questions.
One second, please. I'll answer your question.
So I too wanted to ask that question. What was the outcome, and how did they say that he died? Because when I watched the video, I watched him getting tased. We all watched him getting tased. We all watched him sat in the car. The first time he hit his head 28 times. The second time he hit his head 32 times, and then the third time, I was sitting here counting. He was sitting his head, he was turning his eyes left to right. At first, I thought maybe he was having a seizure because I had never seen the picture before, and I am a seizure person, and I have been a seizure patient for 48 years. That was not a seizure. I don't know what was going on. I know that he got tased. I was trying to count how many times he got tased. But we do need a policy. And I was sitting here and I heard you say that we're not allowed to ask the police officers anything. We have them here. I just need to know, what is the procedure? Why did they go to a hospital which was 30 minutes away? He could have been saved in my mind. He sat in that car for all that long time. And then not only that, I mean, there's a rumor going around that we all have our beliefs. And there's a rumor that the family member or family member had stated that they did not want them to do any resuscitation or didn't want them to do anything for him. When you have seizures, you have to have help if you're having a grandma seizure. You can't just sit there and let a person have a grandma seizure without helping at all. So what I'm looking at, it's two things. What I'm looking at is everybody that played a part in this, everybody did a wrongful thing. Not just one person, it was everyone. And so when the outcome comes out for all the police officers, they all either should not be still working or they all need to not get their job back. You do not sit back and say, well, the two black officers at first, they did not get back on. All the Caucasian and white officers, they got back on with pay. Then the next African-American black guy, officer, he got back on with his back pay. There was one officer who is Keith, and we're all sitting here because Keith came from this neighborhood. And we know a different side of him outside of what we seen. And I seen everybody wrong. I don't know you, Todd Hollis, from a can of paint, but I have seen you, and you have been here helping our people and all people. But in this case, I know that there's nobody that's sitting here that can say that everybody was right, because every single person was wrong. Everybody. I want to know, do you have a contract? Does the city of police have a contract with going all the way past West Penn Hospital, Shadyside Hospital, Presby, and then they go all the way to Mercy? This man could have been saved. I am so sorry. I understand the tasing. I understand it all. But it all played a part. And why didn't everybody do what they possibly could have done to save this man?
I want to speak to her directly. Rocco, could you please move to the side? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know, your camera is like right in the middle of me. So let me.
My daughter, this is her brother, the only one that did not get reinstated to the force. So yes, I have a stake in this because I love this young man. And when you talk about African Americans and anybody, I have a good heart. And I don't want nobody, I don't care who it is, I don't want nobody to die under the hands of the law or under the hands of anybody or black on black crime. What are we here for? We're here and we're watching a video. It's obvious nothing can be done outside of either reinstating all the police officers or firing all the police officers. Why are we here?
I'm about to explain that to you.
Thank you.
All right. We're here because but for this video, there wouldn't be a conversation. But for this video, you and I wouldn't have the opportunity to discuss it. But for the fact that we had to face this hard truth and you're in tears and I feel your pain, no different than the pain that I felt, no different than the pain that Mr. Jordan feels or Katie Kersnick or any of the people who had to watch this video. Okay, you had your opportunity. Okay, so now I'm explaining to you, I don't know why the police officers did what they did. I want to know just as much as you do. The case settled. Want to know something? I mean, I'm going to share it with the whole panel. I didn't want to settle the case. I settled the case because it was in the best interest of my client. If it were up to me, It wouldn't have settled because I didn't want to have to accept the $8 million. I asked for $108. So it wasn't about the money for me, ma'am, because if it was only about the money, I wouldn't have fought so hard to get court approval to release the video. And I'm not concerned about who gets their jobs back. I'm not concerned about criminal penalties. I know Mr. Jordan is. I'm concerned about the next time that my little girl might be walking down Harriet Street, or my cousin might be walking down Harriet Street, and they get, you know, approached by a police officer and they're in the same situation. I can't change the past, but I can do my damnedest to make the future better for not just, you know, decedents of Jim Rogers, but everybody. There's no perfect system. And I'm sorry that this video hurts your loved one, but it hurts mine too. And I've been doing it for 33 years. And I'm gonna keep doing it for as long as I live because this is what God called me to do. And I don't care who likes it. I don't care who doesn't like it. I'm gonna keep doing it. I'm gonna speak my truth for as long as God allows me to do it. Maybe you and I can have a conversation one day because I've never met you either, but I could tell you care about, you know, whomever your loved one is. And I could talk to you privately. I can talk to you privately, and I will talk to you privately. I'll shake your hand. I'll hug you. If you want to scream at me, that's fine. It's okay. But I'm always going to speak the truth. Always. And when I wrote that motion at 3 o'clock in the morning, when I had 400 other thousand things to do, the only reason I wrote it, even though the case had settled, is because I believe in transparency. All right, Dalen, NAACP. Excuse me. Mr. Jordan's wife has a question. Go ahead, I'm sorry, Mr. Jordan. Mr. Jordan, I'm gonna. Mr. Okay.
Two.
Okay, I'm not addressing that. Mr. Jordan, what did you want to say, sir?
I want to say this. This Rosemary Rogers is Jim Rogers, Jim Rogers' mother.
Yes,
this
sir.
Is the older sister.
Yes, sir.
This is the sister, and she helped raise Jim too. She's close to Jim.
Yes,
she's
sir.
She's hurt.
Yes, sir.
Here's the thing. She said $8 million is paid out.
Yes, sir.
Somebody's got liability. Somebody's got responsibility. And the thing is, if somebody tells somebody 8 or 9 times, if I do it, I'm wrong, and he should be dealt with. It should be by the law or whatever. Now you have better sense to do that. Yes, it's a criminal charge. You don't have to be no lawyer to figure that out. And the way they did policy, you can talk about policy, you can play politics. I fear no man and nothing. You know, it ain't about no politics. It's straight up. Yeah, black lives don't matter. Because a black man would have never done that to a white man. You understand? Because he knows he'd have been charged filed on it. He knows that. We got to stand up strong as black people. Right now, I'm going to tell it like it is. Donald Trump is a racist. The reason they voted for him, because they're racist. Don't even vote for a fool like him. And that's why we cannot let these people get away with this. I'm a black man. I know better than do that to our black people. We need justice. My wife is hurt. It hurt her to see that, because she loved him with all heart. And I did too. He loved him. This is his uncle here, over here. That's Rosemary's baby brother. That's our baby, he's the baby, and it hurt us. We hurt. Everybody got their own thing. But Jim was a good kid, and it hurts me. And I have to tell it like it is.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I don't want to keep everybody here all night. I know that the president of the NAACP, Mr. Davis, is here. I'm going to give him an opportunity to speak, and then we're going to close this out. Thank you very much.
$8 million ain't enough money for nobody to lose their life. We all stand here and we all see that this stuff works out. What I'm saying is, what are we doing at this point as a civil rights movement? to change policy? Are we trying to go down? We trying to go down to see the mayor? Are we trying to address what the situation is? He keep avoiding and evading that, acting as if I don't care. I'm sorry, Jim Locke, you lost him. We shouldn't be here today. But as a civil rights lawyer, what you gonna do, player?
All right. As a civil rights lawyer, it's okay. Listen,
hold on, excuse me. Come on, Sam. She's about to answer your question. Okay.
I'm trying to answer this question. You want to know what am I going to do as a civil rights attorney? I'm doing it. I did it. I sued this. Okay, so you don't agree. Okay, but I did it.
But there's another step you can get.
What step would you suggest that I take?
Because the DA hasn't released the final copy.
I am not the DA. If you have an issue with how the DA, Mr. Gibson, if you have an issue. Well, how the DA is doing his job, that's the person you need to be speaking to.
I'm not the lawyer for the DA's office.
Exactly. I'm the lawyer for the family. We filed a civil rights lawsuit. It was settled. It's for the family. It was about the money. We can't bring Mr. Rogers back. Okay, so then you need to address that with Mr. Zappala. Okay, thank you.
All right, good evening, everybody. My name is Dalen Davis. I'm the president of the NAACP Pittsburgh chapter. I have watched this video 3 times now, and each time the humanity in the video was taken out. There was a breakdown in the system when it comes to our police officers, whether it be patrol officers or even the supervisors that were on the scene. It should not have taken them that long to get him to a medical facility, especially when there was a medical facility only 2 blocks away. If this had been a white man in custody, I guarantee you the settlement would be way more than that $8 million. We showed, as a coalition, the video to Senator Jay Costa. His first response when he watched it was the amount of times that man was tased. They had worked on legislation in regards to tasing. Which means, as a current seated elected official, his biggest issue as far as policy was not being followed, because it came out of the direct result, as Mr. Tim Stevens stated, they had advocated for non-lethal weapons. This was a gross misconduct by the Bureau. I am happy tonight that we at least have a commitment from our councilperson, Mosley, and I'm also proud to see that the zone commander is here, but I'm also disappointed not to see Chief Larry Scarrato. He should be here tonight. Not only to make a commitment to have these tough conversations going forward, but also the tough conversations that we are going to have here in the city of Pittsburgh as it relates to our now Republican district attorney. I just want to make sure that we got that correct. You know, and we have a quarterly meeting here coming up tomorrow where we will sit down with Mayor Ganey and Chief Scarrato, and I guarantee you that at least the NAACP, the Alliance for Police Accountability, and BPEP will ask Mayor Ganey, how will he hold the city accountable and his officers accountable for their actions? Now the question is, should these officers be charged by the district attorney? I think you should ask Stephen Zappala that question. Ask him what his views are on it. My views is that there was a breakdown of policy. Supervisors did not do the job, or they didn't know how to do the job, which resulted in this man's death. And over a bicycle. It's sad that we have to sit here in 2024 and have these conversations. It is sad that a man is dead. And it is sad of all the hoops and loops, whether it be through, I'm no lawyer, so don't quote me, you know, whether it be here locally or through federal courts, to get a video released to show them, and I do mean the Pittsburgh Police Bureau, what they got wrong. Any schooling, anybody growing up, you learn as you go. And sometimes you need to admit when you was wrong, correct yourself, and improve. Everybody is human. We all make mistakes. The one thing I also want to say from this video, because I heard the passion from that lady back there. Keith Edmonds, yes, he was the officer that initiated the stop. But from the video, out of all those supervisors, and out of even the transporting officers, he was the first officer to pull Jim Rogers from the video and begin CPR until the medical team got there. Now, where there is wrongdoing, there was a little grace at the end. But overall, a man is dead. And we cannot let that be in this discussion. I also want to acknowledge the Citizens Police Review Board Executive Director was here tonight, and it is my hope that they open an inquiry into the situation with all the officers as well as the supervisors. For they need a report to be generated as far as what specific policies that were failed at the scene. But I don't want to stand here for too long. But that is just what I wanted to express tonight. Todd?
Well said. You sound like Martin Luther King.